The word of the Lord, St. Matthew 6 and 19 says, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust do corrupt, and where thieves break through, and they do what? They steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust does corrupt, neither thieves break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Then St. Matthew 13 and 44 says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth. And for joy thereof, he goes and sells all that he has, and he buys that field. What a blessing. And so today, the Lord bless us, we want to talk about the great treasure hunt.
Amen.
X marks the spot.
All right.
Help me say it again, the great treasure hunt.
The great treasure hunt.
X marks the spot. Now I need you all to go with me. How many like field trips when they were in school?
Yeah.
Stay at school all the time, sitting behind our desk. We might go on a field trip.
Yeah.
Well, today, Mr. Robinson, we're going on a field trip.
Right.
We're going back in time. We used to watch the television shows, cowboys and Indians and all the different westerns. And you all know that every now and then, there would be a treasure. Often a pirate had brought up somebody in the high seas and took their treasure chest full of gold and silver and all kinds of precious jewelry. And it was in a treasure chest. And the pirate, now, when he got to land, he knew, I can't be running around with this thing because, the law enforcement will catch up with me. So I've got to go and hide the treasure. And I've got to put it in a place that's not easy to find. People are going to stumble up on it. I've got to hide the treasure, but just so I can go back and get it later, I need to make a treasure map. So just in case my memory fails me later, I can go back and get my hidden treasure. How many treasure hunters? Remember those stories? So what would happen is he'd go in an unusual place and he would dig a hole. And we heard that our theme for this year is to dig another well. How many remember that?
Yeah.
Well, we're still digging today.
Yeah.
And so he would dig a hole in a certain place and dig. And I'm not talking about like 2 inches, but we're talking about digging a hole. And the treasure would be placed in this hole and put the dirt back on top. And then he would take his foot in and try to stamp down the ground a little bit. And then go get some leaves and things. You all remember this story. You all understand. And they put some leaves on top of things to make it look like no one had dug a hole. So that spot would look like every other spot. Because he had to hide the treasure.
Amen.
Then he makes his map. And on the map, he has a big X, because X marks the what? That's the spot where the treasure is. But there were usually directions on the map. Well, first of all, you'd have to, if you start from here, you got to cross a river. And then you're going to have to climb up a certain mountain. And then when you get to the tallest tree, then you walk 5 paces. And then that's the spot. So he made up his treasure map. Now he couldn't carry the treasure map in his pocket all the time, because what if somebody knocked him in the head, get his map out of his pocket? You know, now they all can get his treasure. So not only did they hide the treasure, but he went and hid the map. But I got good news for somebody today. Treasures of heaven, which are bountiful, they are hidden, but the Lord didn't hide the map. The Lord was so good to us until he published it and he broke it down into 66 sections that we know as books, and then divided them into 2 segments called the Old and the New Testament. And he said, if anybody will look inside of the map, they're sure to find the treasure. It's very interesting, this parable that Jesus gives. And we learned this children that a parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. And this parable Jesus gives about the man that finds the treasure in the field, there's some very interesting things in that passage of scripture. First of all, the scripture says that this man is going about his business and he finds a treasure that is hidden in a field.
Amen.
Which means now the man had to put forth an effort in order to get to the treasure. Because it was hidden in the field. And the thing that he had to deal with, the field is dirt. Help me say dirt. We all have to deal with dirt if we want the treasure. And so it was for the natural treasure hunter, the old cowboy. We can learn a lot from an old cowboy. Well, we can learn a lot from the old cowboy, because when he found a treasure, he gave all his effort to make sure that he could get back to it. How about you and I now, that the Lord has said, I've got a great treasure for you, and invited all of us to come and become treasure hunters. Now you can see the picture of the cowboy. First of all, he has to discover the map. And he found the map, and he didn't run around making some wide advertisement, but he studied the map. And so ought you and I, if wherever we are going to lay hold of the treasures of God, we're going to have to spend some time with the map. Because if we don't know the map, we'll never know where the X is, which marks the spot. So we got to spend some time with the map. And then the old cowboy had enough wisdom to know, I can't do this thing alone. I'm going to need some help if I'm going to lay hold of the treasure. So we get together what they call a posse. These are all his other buddies that are going to help you find the treasure. And you all know the movie was a big to-do to get his posse together, because first of all, he wanted his brother-in-law to go over. His brother-in-law had an attitude, so he couldn't use him. And the other person he wanted was so drunk he couldn't talk to him. So he had to take him and let him dry out while they go try to find somebody else. And you didn't end up with a group that was too good, actually. But he had a mixture of people. But the main thing is, he picked people that were going to help him find the treasure. That man may be drunk right now, but that man's got some skills. He know how to take a stick. I don't know how that works. A stick with a fork in it and go on the ground. And I don't know what he's going to do with it, but somehow that was going to help him. You need somebody that's a tracker. One of the people in the posse need to be a tracker. They know how to look at the eastern sky, where the the sun rises and where the sun sets. And they can track shadows and things of that nature. And based on when the treasure they think it was planted, they can give some ideas. I know he didn't plant it there because that area was flooded at that time. So it can't be there. You need somebody that knows the lay of the land. And then you better have somebody in your posse that's strong. Sometimes they weren't very smart, but you needed always to have a big person who looked like a bouncer that you would have in a pub. Those that have been to pubs and clubs, you don't even know what a bouncer is. A bouncer, that's the big guy that stands in the corner, head shaved, bald. He got on a dark sunglasses, don't smile at anybody, looking all mean. He's the one, if you don't behave, he's going to bounce you out of here. Somebody that's the bouncer. Need somebody with some physical strength. Yeah. So when the others get weak, the bouncer, the strong guy, can keep on going. Because when you get to X mark the spot, you need somebody that can dig, and dig, and dig, and other people with quote unquote good sense will rest. But the guy that's big and strong, you just keep on digging, and they keep on digging because he's looking for the treasure. You need your posse. Now you and I, in our pursuit of God, we're going to need a posse too.
Amen.
You're going to know, you're going to need to have people that you're running with that can help you, Sister Chantel, lay hold of the treasure.
Right.
You're going to need somebody in your posse that knows something about treasure hunting, that's been walking with God a little while, and they know how to find the treasures of God.
Amen.
You're going to need somebody with a little bit of experience in your posse. You don't want everybody that's at your same age and just got saved yesterday, but you need somebody with some experience that knows something about walking with God. Because their testimonies and their stories will be inspirational to you along the way. You're going to need somebody with some spiritual strength in your group that when you find yourself failing and wanting to give up, they'll come and tell you, you can't give up now. Because the Bible says, blessed is he that shall endure unto the end, for the same shall be saved. You're going to need somebody in your group that is the inspirational one. When everyone else is tired, they'll pull out an old broken down violin and start playing. Back then, they sometimes call it a fiddle, and everybody pretty soon start dancing. And when they start dancing and hearing the music, they say even a horse, when you play music, will start dancing. You're going to need some inspiration in your group. So when you get your posse together in the natural, you need some worshipers. And you need some praisers. You need walking with God. And then you're going to need somebody with some experience in reading the map. You're going to need somebody to run with as a Christian. You're going to need somebody that knows their Bible. I'm not talking about the people that always miss Sunday school. I'm not talking about the people that don't even know what YPWW stands for. You're going to need somebody in your group that knows something about the book. Somebody that can pull scriptures out of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. Just go to Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges. Open a room in 1st and 2nd Samuel. Our group, because we are treasure hunters.
Amen.
Now, in order to get the treasure, you have to deal with dirt. Help me say dirt.
Dirt.
And all of those that are faint of heart and can't stand a little dirt to get under their fingernails, you're not going to find a treasure.
Amen.
You know, all of you that are, how many remember Gilligan's Island, that show? Remember Mrs. Howell? If you're like Mrs. Howell, you're not going to find anything.
Thurston, oh dear, in my tent, I believe I saw an ant.
If you're Mrs. Howell, you're not going to find any treasure. You want to find the treasure of God, you're going to need some constitution to you. You're going to need some endurance. You're going to need some commitment. You're going to need some dedication. Sometimes your hands are going to have to get dirty. And sometimes, with the sun beating down upon him, he'd get the canteen and turn it up, and there'd be nothing. And he'd shake it. All the water is gone. And those that were weak of mind and were not committed, they would say, man, we're turning back. And maybe it started out with a group of 15, and then it lost a group because they didn't get to have 3 hot meals a day because they were coming for the food. And then it lose a few more, went back because the water supplies became rations. And then it lost a few because they got tired of riding on the horse. And their body got sore and tired. They wanted to go home and sleep in the bed that night. They were tired of sleeping. And you lose a lot of people, but you get down to a core. God will never leave us alone. He said, I'm with you all. Messenger in the middle of the night. An angel had to come visit Paul while the robbers in the middle of the night telling Paul, don't worry about it. You're going to be on this ship, and the ship is out in the sea, and the sea is raging. Don't worry about it, Paul. The ship is even going to break into pieces, but no line will be lost. Don't worry about it. You are going to make it to land all right. God will make sure you have your life. He may be sitting there. So the old cowboy, even under difficult circumstances, continued. We need persons of like commitment, like dedication in our group. Dirt, there's 4 things that the dirt can pose a problem for you when you're digging for your treasure. First of all, the dirt can basically want to just drive you away. Sometimes the dirt is so hard, you run into so many rocks. There's so many places that you look like your shovel is going to break where you're not making any progress, but don't let the dirt drive you away. Number 2, the dirt can be quite distracting because while you're digging in the dirt, you can see what looks like a treasure in another spot. Because there are some counterfeit treasures. And I knew that this was a spot, but while I was digging, I saw something over there that was useful. So I move over there and start digging. And while I'm digging there, somebody said, hey, look, come over here. And I go over there and start digging. But when you're pursuing Christ, wherever this map, the holy word of God says you're going to find the Lord, that's where you're going to find the Lord. And don't let yourself be distracted by the false, by the counterfeit treasures that this world offers. And not only don't let yourself be driven away or distracted, but the third D, you don't want the dirt to discourage you. Because there'll always be some people around that say, it's not worth the effort. It's not worth the trouble. It doesn't take all of that. I go to church every Sunday, and they're celebrating it like they've done God a great thing. You go to church for 45 minutes and not a moment over, and sometimes you're pleased when it's 44 and 35 seconds. You go your once a week and you feel you've done a great service. But I thought that the Lord said the earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein, which means that everything to God, including our time. We even sing the song, my whole body belongs to God. Our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Even our body is God. Our time is God. Our money is God. We don't have anything. Everything is the Lord's. So we owe him more than punching a clock for a moment. Say we love God with all of our heart and all of our soul and all of our mind and all of our strength. Why would we give God 45 minutes a week and give our job 40 hours a week? Not only 40 hours, but if they say anything about overtime and we think we get time ahead, we'll sign up for that too. When was the last time we gave God 40 hours in a week? He is our chief delight. He is our focus. Our soul pants after him like a deer panted after water. He's our God and we have no other God. Why does he receive often so little and other things so much? Got the treasures mixed up. Laying up treasures on earth rather than laying up the treasure in heaven. That's priority 1. Don't let the dirt drive you, distract you, discourage you. And here's another one. Don't let the dirt dampen your pursuit. Because there will always be people in our life, friends or family, they're happy for you when you say you join the church. They're happy for you when you say, oh, I go to church on Sundays. They're happy when they come over your house. The real sign of Christianity in America, everybody know what that is? The real sign of Christianity in America is a Bible on the coffee table.
Amen.
Oh, you want to see a Christian?
Amen.
A Bible on the coffee table.
Amen.
Wait, wait, and it's open.
What?
It's open too. And a picture of Jesus on the wall.
Amen.
Oh, this is a beautiful Christian home. And you got a necklace on too. And you got a bracelet on too. And you got a bumper sticker too. And you got the rim on your thing on too. We got all of that. So a lot of people don't mind when you do that, but it comes close to home. Some family and friends don't mind when you do those things, but they don't want you to really start living for God.
Amen.
They don't want you to witness to them with a light that is convicting. They don't want your light to shine so much until it convicts them of the darkness that's in theirs. They don't want you to live a life that challenges their lifestyle. They don't want you to live a life that proves that they aren't what they say they are. They don't want you to seek God that seriously until it takes away their time with you. They don't want you to put God first because they want that place. There are some little deeper examples. Some of these are a little bit touchy. They might be a little bit offensive. But I feel it's my assignment to talk about these three. Are we ready? You know, someone did say, the pastor's job is to comfort the disturbed. Isn't that beautiful? But they say, if someone is an evangelist, their job is to disturb the comfortable. Amen? So these might disturb you. But they are from the Lord.
Amen.
All right.
People don't mind a superficial walk, but it gets to be a problem in these areas. Number one, some parents who go to church are uncomfortable when their children get serious about God. They can't handle that because it challenges what they've been doing. And those children that are pursuing God, sometimes the parents, so-called in the name of protecting their child, tell them that's not needful and that's not necessary and this and that. What it really is they're under conviction. Number two, they have their seatbelts on. Some husbands are envious and worse yet, jealous because of their prideful self-worship. And they're offended when their wife becomes a Jesus chaser. When their wife is growing in Christ, and their wife is growing in the Word, and their wife is developing a prayer life, they many times become so angry and so jealous of it until they do things that are unwise. But what the husband doesn't realize is that if his wife is a God chaser, that's to his favor. Because if she's not chasing God, rest assured she is going to chase something. And all those other somethings are not good. Are you with me? Number three, sometimes people in Christian leadership positions, credential holders, whether it be elders or license, mission, whatever, credential people in office that are leading a group, leading an auxiliary, whatever they're leading. Sometimes they are threatened by people they're supposed to be leading who are more fervent for God than they are. And they try to use their position of leadership and authority or whatever their title is to squelch the fire in others to make up for their lack of fire themselves. Every leader is charged to inspire their fellowship of whatever it is to more of God, not less.
Yeah.
The Lord didn't tell us to dumb down our walk to make somebody else comfortable. But God said, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. Seek the Lord.
Yeah.
is the treasure. These scriptures, let me just read them in your hearing. Romans 14:19. Let us therefore, the scripture tells us what to follow after.
Yeah.
Yes, this is what we're to pursue. Here's four things we're to follow after. It says in Romans 14:19, let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace and the things wherewith ye may edify one another.
Yeah.
Peace and things that build up one another. 1 Corinthians 14:1 says, follow after, what do we follow after? It says, follow after charity.
Yeah.
And desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you prophesy.
Yeah.
Desire the spiritual gifts, and especially to be a witness.
Yeah.
Philippians 3:12, not as though I had already attained.
Mm-hmm.
Either were already perfect, but I follow after.
Yeah.
That I may apprehend the thing, I want to lay hold of the thing,
yeah,
which has apprehended me in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
I want to lay hold of the God that has laid hold of me.
Yeah.
Oh, what a blessing. Yeah. He laid hold of me. Lay hold of him. How many know that's the tightest clutch when the person is not only holding you, but you are holding them?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. 1 Timothy 6:11-12. But thou, O man of God, flee. He first going to tell you what to flee and then what to follow. He says, flee these things, talking about the things of worldly pleasures and things of the lust of the flesh. Instead, it says, follow after righteousness. Let me say righteousness.
Righteousness.
Godliness.
Godliness.
Faith.
Faith.
Love.
Love.
Patience.
Patience.
Meekness.
Meekness.
Fight the good fight of faith.
Fight the good fight of faith.
And lay hold on eternal life.
Lay hold on eternal life.
Those are the things. That's Jesus. That's what we are to pursue in this great treasure hunt. Where X marks the spot. What then, how then, do we find our ultimate victory as these treasure hunters? We ultimately find our victory in these 10 things. We find our victory, number one, because we have studied the map, learned it well, which is the Word of God.
Amen.
Number two, we follow it carefully.
Yes.
Every Christian needs to make the knowledge of the Word of God a very high priority.
Yes.
Somehow a man, the study of the Word of God is such a low priority, and that's not a good thing.
No.
But the study of the Word of God and then follow it. But you can't follow what you don't know.
Yes.
And then to teach it unto others, and we can't teach what we don't understand.
Amen.
Number three, be determined to find the treasure.
Yes.
Even when the water supply is low and when the sun is hot, and when you find that those around you are not encouraging, and especially if you didn't find the treasure immediately like you thought. Because X does mark the spot.
Amen.
But that doesn't mean there's not 2 inches here, 2 inches there. It marks that region. So it does require some effort.
Yeah.
Some of us have said, I tried seeking the Lord, but because I didn't get what I was looking for right away, I stopped in my pursuit.
Yeah.
But this was a lifelong pursuit.
Yeah.
We chase him in the morning, we chase him in the middle day, and we chase him when the sun is going down. Number four, select your posse carefully.
Yeah.
You need people that are like-minded about the treasure, who are number one, committed, and number two, they're focused.
Yeah.
Many people have set out on a treasure hunt, and because of chaos and dissension within the posse, they lost their focus on the treasure. And even though they were close to getting the treasure, they missed the treasure because the group was divided. We need time with one another. Fellowship, as we're often encouraged by our pastor, fellowship with other believers of like-mindedness to teach us commitment and focus on the Lord. Even Gideon started out with tens of thousands, but God whittled it down to 300. Number five, select experienced treasure hunters because they've been that way before. Number six, don't listen to the negative voices because these are the doubters who don't believe in the richness and the value of the treasure. Watch out for them. Watch out for them. Just because your posse started out with somebody in it, they don't have to stay in it. As we walk with God, many times certain people in the posse have to fall out to make room so God can bring somebody in. Sometimes we're so afraid that we won't have buddies and partners and homies and whatever you want to call them until we hold on to people in unprofitable relationships because we don't want to be by ourselves. But if you're a believer, you can't be by yourself. Thank you. treasure. The place God's calling you for a relationship or a friendship you think you can't live without. Sometimes something drastic happens and that relationship is lost, and there's all this mourning. Whereas the Lord wanted us to love one another always, but sometimes those unprofitable relationships, we go beyond love to clinging. Clinging. We're not to stick to anything like flypaper, but God Himself. Some things come out of our life, and sometimes they have to come out. That doesn't mean we don't love people. We do love them. We care. And we do mourn. There's a hurt there. But it's better to mourn the hurt and get over it and get that relationship out of your life than to get between to it and let that be torn down. You know they hold the treasure of Jesus. You know God has great and mighty and wonderful things for people, and we all know that it's our blessing. What is the treasure worth? It's worth everything.
Yes.
The most valuable good thing, God, heaven has pearl gates made out of pearl and street made out of pure gold. Riches are nothing but the blood of His Son. That's worth everything. Number six, not listening to the doubters. Number seven, the treasure, saints, is real. And that treasure is Jesus. Number eight, the treasure is worth the pursuit. Number nine, stay the course.
Oh my God.
Tell somebody, stay the course. Tell somebody, tell them, ourselves to anything. and we have not risen to commit ourselves to you. But guess what? It's January. It's a brand new year. And you're going to be in the house today. And the invitation goes out to every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl. You're not too young to be saved. You're not too old to be saved. You're not too young to have a fresh start. And you're not too old to have a fresh start. Whether from this side of the tracks or from that side of the track. Well, I tried before and failed. That's okay, because you know what? When we try, we fail. But when we let the Spirit do it, He never fails. If you're here today and you're not saved, if you're here today and Jesus isn't your Lord, His arms are open wide lovingly to you to receive you as His own. Hallelujah, that's good news. He died for everybody, and His love is still strong. And if you're here today and you're not saved or you're not sure, come now and receive the Lord as Savior. He's not only Savior, but He's keeper. He'll keep what we can't keep. He'll direct us and lead us. Maybe you're here today, you're saved, but you're saying, I want to get a fresh start. I just want to get a renewal. I just want to get myself on focus. I want a new commitment and a new dedication unto the Lord. I want to leave this place today, not as a show for others, but I want to leave this place today with a new commitment and a focus on Christ as my treasure that I've never had. If you're here, we'll pray with you. If you have other needs, pray for them. Need anybody, need anybody, whatever they need, we will pray with you today. The Lord knows.